Hi, good morning. Happy Sabbath. Welcome back to another Live at Revision.
Yay.
Here we are so excited to speak with you before our worship experience gets started. My name is Christelle.
And I'm Jessica.
And we're so happy to have you here. So Jessica, tell us a little bit about what Live at Revision is for our first time viewers.
Yes. So Live at Revision is the time where we go over and recap the amazing things that we have going on here at Revision Church. We also spotlight different ministries and just really have conversations about what we are dealing with as everyday Christians and how we're trying to make an impact with our community and our church.
I love that. And we have so many exciting things that we're going to share with you today. But for all of our viewers who might not be in the building and might not be in person, we always love to get you involved. Yes. And I have an icebreaker question for you. Today, we want to know, what are you praying for God to do this year? As we get into the end of January, it's crazy that it's almost the end of January already.
Like, yes. You blink and it's now February.
It's crazy. But we want to pause and just think about our intentionality this year.
You know?
What are you praying for God to do this year? Put it in the chat if you're viewing online. What about you, Jessica? What are you praying for God to do?
What am I praying for God to do this year? I'm praying that God activates the anointing. Okay, I need him to activate the anointing that he has in my life. This year, I have just said, you know, God, if you give me opportunities that I know that it will only be you to be able to help me execute.
Yeah.
Like, I'm not going to just do it. I'm going to do it scared, you know, and I'm going to do it just with faith.
Yes.
Right. And so there's a lot of things and that he's placed on the inside of me. And I think in the last 2 years, you know, we've gone through the pandemic.
Yeah.
A lot of us been, you know, had to isolate. We have to, you know, just sit on some of those things or push back some of those goals or those opportunities. And now I feel like in 2023, God is like, activate the anointing, go forth, and do what I called you to do. So I'm excited. What about you?
I'm going to piggyback off of that, Jessica, because I think I'm there too. Doing it scared. That's key.
Yes, doing it scared.
I'm praying for God to prepare me for that. You know, so sometimes, you know, we always are asking for these blessings.
Yes.
And we want, you know, that next big thing or we want that next step. But I'm asking God to prepare me for that.
I'm praying for that.
Preparation.
Love it. So what about you? What are you praying for God to do this year? We want to hear from you in the chat. So if you can type it in Facebook or YouTube, let us know and we can read them out.
Love that. All right. Michelle S. says, praying for discernment so that I might want what God wants from me. That's a big one.
So key.
That's a good one.
We need the discernment. Oh, Robin says, I'm praying for God to give me wisdom. It's tiring to be a lost girl. Wisdom. We all need some wisdom.
Yes. I love that. And the discernment and the wisdom, that reminds me of our previous our previous season that we had with small groups. That's what it was all about.
Yes.
So I love
wisdom and discernment and just knowing the will of God and also doing the will of God is really key. But you have to know before you can do.
So I love that. Thanks so much for sharing some of those answers. We want to go ahead and get you up to date on what we're actually doing next weekend, and that's with our STEM program. So if you've been catching up or keeping up with us, we've been talking about our STEM program with Angel Tree, and that's happening next week, January 28th. That's going to start at 9 a.m. It will be from 9 to 12. And actually, we're already at full capacity. So we were trying to get 130 kids involved in our STEM program, and we're already there. So this is a reminder for all of those who have registered that we're going to see you next week at 9 a.m. to 12 p.m. So
look
forward to see you guys there.
Yeah. And we also have an amazing project that we are doing today here live at Revision. It is the MLK Service Project, where we are coming together as church members and we're going to help feed 10,000 people today.
Wow.
And so immediately after church, we need you. We need our volunteers to come stay after church where we can bag lunches, 10,000 bags. To feed families that are dealing with food insecurities across the Atlanta, Greater Atlanta area. And so we are asking for your participation. for your humbleness to come and serve and help these families. The more that we, more volunteers, probably the less bags we have to do per person. So yeah. we need as many participants today. Lunch is provided too for volunteers. So if no excuses. You know, no excuses. Like, we're going to come help the hungry, and then you're going to get fed as well. So, you know, spiritually and physically fed. We need you. So we're excited. This is the MLK Service Project. I think Pastor Gina was spearheading this project. And so she'll have more details too throughout this service, just what this project is going to do and help with our community. But we are looking for volunteers. So if you can stay after church, that'd be greatly appreciated.
We look forward to seeing you there.
Yeah.
And speaking of that, Jessica, actually the opposite of it. A lot of us are doing fasting this month.
Yeah, yes.
Usually a lot of us come into January and we do our Daniel fast. I know as a church group together, we'll be starting our fast this week.
Yes.
So I really want to, you know, kind of bring that conversation home for those who may not have ever fasted before.
Yeah.
You may not understand the reason of fasting. And Jessica is actually fasting right now.
Yes.
And so, you know, we just want to ask you, Jessica, about your experience with fasting and what that's been like.
Yeah. So my experience with fasting is really when I try to do in the beginning of the year, right? In that, at least the January, I usually wait until after MLK weekend, where I know I can really just set my intentions. Mm-hmm. And I know that fasting for me, it's the prayer and the fasting that goes hand in hand.
Yeah.
So my prayer life truly increases when I start doing a fast. So right now I am doing the Daniel fast, and I was just telling you this where I'm like, Christelle, I'm so hungry and tired. But it's a humbling experience where I can deny my flesh.
Yeah.
I deny myself, and I'm really just like, God, you know, I can at least sacrifice this little small part of what I would normally crave and normally want when it comes to all the processed foods and carbs. And I'm now just living off of fruits and vegetables.
Yeah.
But it's amazing because you start to feel refreshed.
Yeah.
You start to feel revived during the fast. Sometimes, yes, you'll have your days where it's hard. And when you do, that's where I go into prayer. Mm. That's where I was like, okay, it's time for me to have a quick prayer, you know, so to get my mind right and to get to refresh my spirit, because I start feeling a little tired and depleted.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's an experience where I know I write out exactly what I'm praying for in that moment so that I can see, and I journal.
Yeah.
Journaling is very key, I would say, during a fast, you know, just so that you can look back and see like how you have been tracking, like with your feelings and your emotions and what you've been praying and seeking for. And you'll slowly start to see God, just the Holy Spirit really just coming in and like just making you feel light.
Wow.
Like I physically feel light because I am denying myself of all the sugars and processed foods that kind of weigh us down, right? But then also spiritually, I start feeling light.
That's
so it's a good experience. I always, you know, charge my family and friends to at least try to incorporate some type of fast,
right,
whether it's food or if it's social media or if it's, you know, it can be anything, right? That you can just try to deny your flesh from so that you can say, God, less of me, more of you in that space.
I love that. And I do think it takes a bigger discipline. It shows how much,
you know, the discipline.
We do lean on some of these things.
Correct.
Right?
Yeah.
Instead of probably leaning on God, you know, in some of these times.
Yeah.
That's good.
I mean, if you think about it, sometimes food can be an emotional comfort.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we have that comfort food. And personally, I would struggle with that. Yeah. So now it's like, okay, I can't, if I'm feeling sad or upset or I had a stressful day at work, I can't go run to the candy bar.
Oh, mac and cheese.
I can't go run and get the, you know, like, I'm like, okay, God, like, what is water? Water has become my best friend because I'm not drinking any other beverages. Mercy. No other beverages for 30 days. But when I tell you, the water is feeling like holy wine. It feels like holy wine at this point. And I tell you, it just cleansed my mind and my spirit. And it also helps with my appetite, curbs the appetite too. And so it's, I know it's a spiritual thing happening when I'm fasting.
I love that, Jessica. And I think, You know, that's really, really good, you know, to kind of put things in perspective like that. Mm-hmm. But, you know, for someone who's thinking, man, you know, I don't really have a reason to fast, or I don't really know why I would be fasting. You know, what would you say to that person who's questioning whether fasting is for them at this season?
Yeah, I would say don't overthink saying you have to have a reason to fast. It's a humbling experience. It's for you to humble yourself in the presence of the Lord. Daniel humbled himself and said, you know what? I really don't have to, but I'm going to, because I need to show them that my God is the God that can do miracles. He's the God that can provide and save. And so I'm going to pray three times out of a day and deny myself of the king's food that they were offering, just to show. So it was a humbling experience. And I feel like whatever that you're going through, or that, you're just wanting to get clarity, right? Maybe there's so much clutter, so much noise.
We need that a lot.
We need it. So just like a social media break where you just say, hey, I'm going to take a week or about 20 days or 21 days off of social media so that I can just cleanse my mind, and so that I can ask God for some clarity or some peace. You never know what the shift might happen, how that might happen.
I'm excited, Jessica. Yes. Thank you for that. I think it makes it really practical, and it also helps us to remember what is most important right now, and that is going to God, you know, instead of going and leaning on what we sometimes see as a crutch. I'm excited because next week is the week we actually start our fast.
Right.
And so there's going to be lots of more information coming your way. Stay tuned to our social media so you can find out more about what we'll be doing per day or per week. And we'll see you there. I'll be partaking in that.
Yes, too. I'm excited.
Me too. Well, we're so excited that you stayed here with us during Live at Revision. And now it's time to intro into our worship experience. So we're going to go ahead and switch over to us in church. And we hope that you stay and tarry a little bit longer to enter into worship with us. Thank you. We'll see you there.
Take me to the water, body going under. And when I come up, I can feel the sun shining on my face. And like a janitor, you got me cleaned up. You made me a believer. Blind mark on my soul has been erased. And now that I've been with you,
Welcome to church. We gather to worship an amazing God who created the heavens, the earth, all that lives, crucified, buried, risen, holy. Jesus is good. Jesus is forever. You are loved. You are accepted. You belong. Welcome to Revision Church.
Good morning, Revision Church family. Are you happy to be in the house of the Lord? It is a new year. It's a new day. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice. Now, this morning, we've got an old school favorite. We are reaching back into the annals of time. So if you want to be a big church choir, if your dream was always to be in a choir, now is your time to stand on up to your feet, and we're going to take it back to Hezekiah Walker days, all right? Come on, put those hands together like this.
All of my life, I never known you to fail. You remain the same, and wonderful is your name. All of my life, I never known you to fail. You remain the same, and wonderful is your name.
Come on, help me sing.
All of my life, I never known you to fail.
For the rest of my life, Any altos in the building this morning?
For the rest of my life, yay. I'll serve him. For the rest of my life.
Come on, let's hear you sing it.
For the rest of my life.
That's it.
I'll serve him. For the rest of my life.
Just one big choir this morning. All right, come on, tenors. Come on, ladies.
For the rest of my life.
All right, any tenors out there, let me hear you sing it.
For the rest of my life, I'll serve him. For the rest of my life.
All right, let's put that thing together. For the rest of my life.
For the rest of my life.
Good morning and happy Sabbath, church. Good morning and happy Sabbath. Oh, come on, you all can do better than that. Good morning. Awesome, awesome, awesome. We're so excited that you all decided to worship with us this morning here in person at Revision Church.
Yes, good morning. Good morning and happy Sabbath. We would like to welcome our online visitors. Thank you so much for worshiping with us today.
Today is just a great day because we have so much going on. Many of you all know that after church today, we have amazing service initiative planned in honor of MLK weekend. But not only that, but tomorrow we're kicking off our prayer and fasting. Praise the Lord. It's time. Oh, come on. You all can do better than that. Listen, some folk are already looking like, I'm about the prayer, but I don't know about the fasting. But listen, this is our time in worship where we want to engage through an icebreaker, something that's fun. But in lieu of the fact that we're starting prayer and fasting, we wanted our icebreaker to be centered around that. And so our first question for today is,
what does prayer do for you, and or what has prayer done for you? So what we're going to have you do, if you're in the audience, turn to your neighbor and have a quick conversation. And for those online, we will read off their responses. So what has prayer done for you, or what does prayer do for you?
Go ahead, turn to your neighbors.
And have a little conversation.
And if you're online, just go ahead and just drop your response in the chat. What has prayer done for you? And what is it currently doing for you? What has prayer done for you? And what is it currently doing for you?
All right, so Amber says, prayer unburdens the heart.
Ooh, that's good. Anybody can resonate with that? That prayer unburdens your heart? Yeah, yeah, I see some hands out there. That prayer unburdens your heart. That's good. That's good. Yeah. We have somebody else. Stefan says, prayer provides a sense of peace and relief. Yeah. Does prayer do that for anyone out there?
Yes.
You feel kind of like overwhelmed sometimes, and it just provides a sense of relief? Yeah. I know for me, prayer does that.
Yeah, it does. And Ruth says, prayer is the factor that has kept my peace.
Ooh,
yes,
prayer,
I definitely agree with that.
Prayer keeps your peace. Sometimes when things aren't going well and you feel overwhelmed and somebody's getting on your nerves at your job or maybe even your children, sometimes it's prayer that gives us a sense of peace. Jimmy Howell says, prayer helps me keep in tune with God. Mm-hmm. I love that, Jimmy. Prayer says, prayer allows me to be in tune with God. Jimmy says alignment.
And Lene says, it reminds me I can talk to God about anything.
Ooh, that's so good. That it reminds us that we can talk to God about anything. Does prayer do that for you all here today? That it reminds you that we can talk to God? I know sometimes in prayer, my life can be so chaotic, jumping from one thing to the next, but it's so great to know that we serve a God that I can talk to amidst the chaos.
Yeah.
And that can give me a sense of peace and a sense of rest.
Yeah, and to piggyback on that, talk to God about anything, but at any time and anywhere.
Yeah.
And that's what I love about prayer. It is not a certain time that you can do it anywhere at any time.
Anytime. Sometimes I find myself praying in the car.
Oh, yeah, I love praying in the car.
Eyes not closed. I'm praying today. Amen. Praying in the car. Listen, our second question this morning is this. If you have fasted or prayed or fasted before, what was your experience? Would you rate your experience as it went great? Would you say it went okay? Or are you just going to be honest here today and say, I'm just not a fan. Would you say it went great? Would you say it went okay? Or would you be like, I tried it before. I'll be honest, I'm not a huge fan.
Let's see a show of hands. If it's great, if fasting goes great for you, just raise your hand.
Okay. We got some hands raised.
Just
okay.
A few. If fasting's okay, raise your hand. Okay.
Okay, kind of in between. It's okay. Like, it's good, but it's a little hard. It's a little hard.
And I'm not a fan. Okay.
No. We got some
honest
folk.
I love the honesty.
We got some honest folk. I love that.
Yeah.
Sharon in the chat says, it was great. She said her experience was great. Amber C said, great things come out of fasting. That's awesome. Michelle Duncan says, honestly, she says, I'm not a fan. I know we have some folk in here can attest to that. Honestly, I'm not a fan. Awesome. Shelly Thomas, grandma.
Hi,
she says, it went excellent. Gave me power that I didn't know I had.
Yeah.
Oh, that's a word right there, is that she said that when she fasted, she got power that she didn't know she had. That's awesome. That's beautiful.
Yeah. Kenyon says, just okay. I get too hungry, LOL.
I get a little too hungry.
I think you have experienced that before.
Oh, you got to put me on blast. That's true. It's true. We started fasting 2 weeks ago, y'all. And usually, like, fasting for me, like, usually, but the first week is kind of hard. And the second week, I'm usually locked in. Church, I'll be honest, I've been struggling this year of 2023. I mean, we've been doing the Daniel fast. We've been doing grains and salads and vegetables and fruit. I've never been so tired of fruit and vegetables in my life. But I can testify that although, like, it's been a struggle, it's been pushing me. And it's been doing something for me that I know I can't do for myself. And that's allowing me to be in attunement with God and allowing me to be able to hear from God. Sometimes we have to be able to move things out of our lives in order for us to be able to hear from God. Maybe that's social media. Maybe that's food. I know that when I'm stressed sometimes, I love to come home and I love some ice cream. I love to go to some ice cream that's in the freezer. But this week has been pushing me because when I'm stressed, I can't have the ice cream to turn to. But I have my Lord that I can turn to. And so today we want to encourage you all, church, as we begin to pray and fast, we encourage you to take part with us. It's an opportunity for us to be in attunement with God. And our last question today is...
Yeah, so this is another question. If you're in the audience, you can turn to your neighbor. And if you're online, you can put your answers in the chat. What are you expecting or hoping God to show you in this season of fasting? What are you hoping? Or hoping to experience in this season of fasting, whether you're fasting from food, social media, certain vices, whatever it is, you can share that with your neighbor and we'll read some responses online. I think I'm hoping that God can just declutter and take out what doesn't need to be there.
I like that. I think for me, I'm just hoping for clarity, hoping to just be able to clearly hear God and be able to see his movement. And so go ahead, just turn to your neighbor really quickly. What are you expecting to hear from God in this fasting and praying season of 2023? What are you hoping for? What are you hoping for? What are you hoping to hear from God? And if you're online, go ahead and just drop that in the chat. What are you hoping to receive from the Lord this year of 2023?
Jimmy says directions and revelations.
Directions and revelations. Oh, I love that. Amber says, I'm hoping to experience great power and full anointing.
Oh, amen.
Oh, I love that. Sharon said, show me what he wants me to do in 2023 to help others.
Yeah, Keisha says clarity.
Clarity. Clarity. Clarity. Ooh, anybody out there want some clarity? Some clarity in 2023? I see some hands. Kenya says, direction on how to reduce stress and reach goals. Oh, I love that.
Deborah says to remind me that he is the only God.
That he is the only God. Oh, excellent. Leobardo says revelation. Leobardo says, I need a revelation from the Lord here in 2023. Lucien says, hoping for clarity and direction. For clarity and direction. Carissa says, also direction and clarity. Is there somebody out here today that wants some direction in 2023? You're wanting some clarity? Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Church, again, as we enter into this prayer season, we want you to go into this prayer season knowing that God is going to answer your prayers, knowing that he's listening, that we just don't serve this inanimate God that's outside, that's looking in, but rather we serve a God that's living inside of us, and we serve a God that can empathize with us. And so church, today, as we go to the Lord in prayer, I want us to be able to pray to God this morning with boldness and confidence. Can we do that here? And so I invite you to just get into a prayer posture, whether that's standing up, maybe that's kneeling, whatever your prayer posture is this morning, I just want to encourage you to go there as we seek the Lord in prayer, knowing that we're praying to a God that is listening. So we're going to pray with boldness. We're going to pray with confidence. Let us pray. God, Lord, we're so happy this morning that we serve a God that we can call Father. God, that we can serve a God that we can call companion, because, Lord, you empathize with us. Lord, you know what we're going through before the trial or situation even arose. God, Lord, you know what's going on the inside of us. God, you know that we're stressed. Lord, you know that we're weak. Lord, you know that we're at crossroads and we don't know which way to turn. God, you know what's on our hearts and our minds this morning. And God, we're so grateful that we serve a personal God. We don't have to go before a secretary or any administrative assistant, but God, Lord, we can pray to a God who created the heavens and the earth, the sea and all that's in the midst. And God, we're so grateful that we can call on our Creator no matter the time. God, we're so grateful that we can call on you whether we're in our car, whether we're at our job, whether we're going through something, whether we're not going through something. God, we're so grateful that we can call on you no matter the circumstances in our lives. And God, Lord, we're so grateful because, Lord, your word says that you dwell within us. And so, God, we're so grateful that you are this creator, God, but we're also grateful that you live in the midst of us. And so, God, with that this morning, we're praying for boldness and confidence. We're praying for a boldness that we only know that you can give. God, Lord, may we understand that in 2023, Lord, we're walking into this year with anointing. May we understand and recognize the power that we have. May we understand that we can tell doors to open and we can also tell doors to close. May we also understand, Lord, that we know who you are. And God, may we be able to testify and prophesy about your goodness. God, Lord, we pray that 2023 won't look like the other years. God, Lord, we pray that in this year we would enter into a loving relationship with you. Lord, we pray that we would be so on fire, Lord, that we can tell demons about the God that we serve. And so, God, Lord, here today, Lord, we're here with our arms wide open, God, ready to receive what you have for us. And so, God, as we go into this season of prayer and fasting, God, Lord, we're praying for clarity. We're praying for direction. God, Lord, we pray that you tell us what path to go down. God, Lord, we pray that you may give us instruction. God, Lord, we pray that we may be able to tap into the power that only comes from you. God, Lord, we pray that we may receive something in these 3 weeks of prayer and fasting. And God, Lord, we know the enemy is angry because, Lord, we know the word says that when people pray, things happen. We see in Acts that when the church prayed, the jail doors opened. And so, God, Lord, we believe that when we pray over the next 3 weeks, that prison doors will open, that chains will be loose, that barriers will be broken down, that walls will be broken down. And so, God, Lord, we pray that you may have your way with us. God, Lord, we pray that as we worship today, that our worship would be authentic and genuine. God, Lord, we pray that you may give us something, but God, we pray that we may also give you the best that we have. This is our prayer. Let everybody who believes in Jesus say amen. Amen, amen. Church, today, again, we want to invite you to worship with us. We're not here to just sit down and be spectators, but we want to engage the Holy Spirit because we believe that he's done some amazing things. So as our praise team comes back here today, we invite you to stand up on your feet and give God the praise that he is due.
We sing the praises to our King because he is the King of Kings. He is the Lord of Lords. He is the Lord strong and mighty for you. For you, for me. Oh, we just one big church choir today, so y'all might as well just get up on those feet and sing with us. Come on.
We sing the praises to our King, for he is the King of Kings. We sing the praises to our King, for he is the King of Kings.
Come on.
We sing the praises to our King, for he is the King of Kings. We sing the praises to our King, for he is the King of Kings.
Give him glory,
for he is the King. Give him glory.
you know that your God is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, and his reign never ends. That his reign never ends. There is no time that can contain him. His reign never ends. He is the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. And God, you reign forever. Can we just let that seep in over us? That your God is a forever God. Before you were formed, he knew you. Before you had a name, before your mom met your dad, he was forever loving you. He was already loving you. And there's just something about that name this morning. Do you know that name? Do you know that name this morning? Something about the name Jesus. Something about the name Jesus. It is the sweetest name I know. And oh, how I love the name Jesus. Oh, how I love the name Jesus. It is the sweetest His name, yeah. I know. Have me sing something
about the name Jesus.
Ooh,
something about the name Jesus.
It is the sweetest.
It is the sweetest name.
How about you?
I know.
One more time.
I know
something about the name Jesus.
About the name Jesus.
Just something about
something
his name.
About the name Jesus.
When I speak the name,
it is the
when I call his name.
Say, I know.
Do you know it?
I know.
Come on, let's lift it one more time, church.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, there's something about that name, Jesus, today. Oh, there's a sweet, sweet spirit in this place. Oh, come on, put your hands together and bless God one more time. Just keep playing that under me right there. Precious Jesus. Because of the name, we got victory. All the spirits move. Just sing it again softly. Sing it again. Come on, come on, come on. Tell me. Tell me. Who can stand before when we call on that great name? Jesus, precious Jesus, we have the victory. Hallelujah. Right there where you are at home, hallelujah. right here in this building. Hallelujah. Oh, God, we praise him today. We praise him today. We got so caught up, we forgot to let the children know that they can go to children's church. So if you are here in the building, I see parents, they got the cue already. Excuse us, we just got caught up calling on his name. But all the children, all the precious children who Jesus loves and values, we've got a special time prepared for you. So parents, at this time, you can escort them to their prepared place. And don't worry, we have enough runway here so that when you get back, you'll be back in time for the word. So we're grateful. We praise God for our children's ministry team and all that they do. Let's put our hands together for them. They do a lot of hard work, y'all, a lot of preparation, a lot of planning that goes into this, and we are grateful. We're so grateful for our praise team and musicians who have, they don't just sing, but they minister by the power of the Holy Spirit. And we're grateful for all the gifts that we have through them. We're especially grateful today for a precious gift in the body of Christ, particularly here at Revision Church Atlanta. We are blessed to have on our staff one whose birthday is today, Pastor Tiffany Brown. It's her birthday. Come on, church. Come on, come on. Pastor Tiffany, just stand, turn to the folks and wave. Everybody in the chat, just drop that happy birthday in the chat. We are so grateful. She's 25 today. Listen, on the count of three, just say, we're not going to sing happy birthday, but we're going to wish her happy birthday on the count of three. I just want everybody to shout happy birthday. All right? All right. One, two, three. We want you to know we love you. We want you to know that you are valued here at Revision Church Atlanta. And we're not going to bring your gift up here, but we did get a gift for you. Church, y'all bought her a gift. Amen. You didn't even know. Y'all bought her a gift. Amen. And we celebrate you today. Grateful. This is a high day to have a birthday. And then on the Sabbath day, what an awesome time. And so we want you to know that we love you and we appreciate you today. We are excited not only about that, but about the opportunity that we have to serve today in alignment with our mission. We have an opportunity to partner. We're partnering with Rise Against Hunger. Today, at the end of this worship experience, we are going to prepare packets for 10,000 people who are experiencing food insecurity. Come on, come on, you can do better than that. Right there in the chat, come on, just put some praise hands there, some applauding hands. So listen, Rise Against Hunger and Revision Church Atlanta is linking up today to do this. They say that we need only about 50 volunteers. We've streamlined the process that within an hour, we will have 10,000 packets done, all right? And so I'm believing God, because this is just how Revision Church is, that you're going to do more than 50. Now, here's the thing. We're going to have lunch for you. So if you're thinking, well, I would, but I got to eat, we got you covered. Amen, church? We got a good lunch for you. So while they're flipping the rooms from children's church to the place, the staging place where we're going to do the packets, you'll be able to eat, have some time, hang out, talk to some people, meet some new people, and then we'll be ready to start after service. And so we hope that you'd stay by with us. We need at least 50. I'm believing we're going to have 75, 80, 90 people. Stay by and help us, all right? Here's the thing. This is in alignment with our mission, because we're always talking about the fact that we exist to reintroduce Jesus, to 10,000 people, to the city of Atlanta and beyond. And one of the ways we do that is that we engage in serving our community through selfless service. Today you got an opportunity. And so I want to thank you in advance for how you're going to show up, Revision Church. And I also want to thank you for how you signed up for STEM Saturdays. STEM Saturdays is our next project. See, we're serious this year. We're going to be out in these streets. Amen. Next week, STEM Saturday, is when we are going to be partnering with another organization as we expose young people who don't always get the opportunity to science, technology, the area of engineering and math. And we've got a whole thing planned out for next Saturday. We hope that you will join us for that time. I will say this, in fact, I'm just remembering now, I should thank you because we actually don't need any more volunteers. We have more than enough. So come on, put your hands together and thank God. We've got all that we need. All that we need. So thank you. Tomorrow we begin our time of fasting and prayer. And I'm hoping that you will join us for the next 3 weeks, the next 21 days, believing that God is going to do remarkable and amazing things. You might say, is this just for the members? Well, it's designed for anybody, whether you are a member of Revision Church Atlanta or not, whether you're here in Atlanta or anywhere around the world watching us. We want for you to join us in this 21 days of fasting and prayer as we are leveraging the power of prayer, as our mission statement states. We want you to join us. We're going to be, for the next 3 weeks, fasting and praying, believing God to do exceedingly and abundantly above anything we could ask, dream, or desire. I want to let you know that in week one, just to give you an overview, week one, we're going to be fasting from social media and all secular entertainment so that we can just kind of cut out the noise and the clutter. I knew I wouldn't have a whole lot of folks clapping right through here. There's somebody who's going through withdrawal right now. Like, oh my God, I got to stay off the gram. Oh my God, I can't be on Twitter to share my opinion about everything. This week, for the first week, you're going to take a little break from that. And listen, I've done this before. There are periods of time where I do this, and I probably got some witnesses here. There are certain things you hear from God, certain things you sense from God that you don't get when you have all the noise. Somebody say amen. That's the first week from social media and secular entertainment. So, you know, your show's going to be there, all right? It's going to be there. Week number two, we're going to be fasting from meat, dairy, and fried foods. So you're going to drive by Krispy Kreme, even though the light is on, because they fry them things. Meat, dairy, fried foods. And then week three, our final week, we're fasting from sweets, desserts, energy drinks, and carbonated drinks. Now, here's what I want you to understand. Fasting is not about what you cannot do. I'm going to say it again. Fasting is not. I do not want you, beloved, to focus on what you cannot do in the next 3 weeks. I want you to understand that we fast from these things so that we make ourselves more available for what God wants to give us in lieu of these things. So it's not negative, it's actually positive. We start the year out like this every year because we believe, as we have been anointed and called for greatness in 2023, that some things don't change, some things don't come unless we fast and pray. Who says amen today? Put your hands together if you're going to fast and pray with us. Well, there is a word from the Lord today in this vein and within the alignment of our mission. For we exist to reintroduce Jesus. One of the ways is through leveraging the power of prayer. Today, I want you to understand that our mission statement is not just something we say, it's something that we are called to live out. So I want to focus today and next week on this first part of our mission, how we reintroduce Jesus by leveraging the power of prayer. I want you to join me in Luke chapter 22. Would you stand to your feet if you're in this building with me? Luke chapter 22. I'm going to read in your hearing some verses, just a couple. Luke chapter 22, we're going to read verse 31 and 32. And I'm just going to read these. I've got another text, but we won't get to that till next week. So Luke chapter 22, verse 31 through 32. Today I'll be reading and preaching from the English Standard Version, as is my custom. It's the version that I like, but you can read whatever version you're comfortable with. We'll also have it on the screen. For those of you who are online, you're watching us on Facebook and on YouTube, we invite you to make sure you read this with us as we prepare for the word. If you're ready, shout yes. The Bible says in Luke 22, verse 31 and 32, "Simon, Simon, behold, Satan has demanded to have you, that he might sift you like wheat. But I have prayed for you, that your faith may not fail. And when you have turned again, strengthen your brothers." Now I'm going to read it again with emphasis, but I want you to understand, whenever in the Bible, almost every Bible, regardless of the version you are reading, you will see in the New Testament, particularly in the Gospels, those words written in red. These are the words of Jesus. "Simon, Simon, behold, look, pay attention. Satan demanded to have you, that he might sift you like wheat. But I have prayed for you, that your faith may not fail. And when you have turned again, strengthen your brothers." Oh Lord, have your way today. Let's pray. Father, have your way now in this place. For if we ever needed the Lord before, we sure do need you now. Come in your strength. Come in your power. I stand in the promise that your word will not return unto you void, but it will accomplish that which you send it out to do. So speak, and we will hear you. Speak, and we will not just be informed, but we will be transformed. Speak, yokes will be broken, minds changed, lives transformed in Jesus' name. Let everyone say amen and amen. You may be seated. May be seated. We praise God. Today I want to preach from the subject, "You Got Leverage." Turn to your neighbor and say, "You got leverage." You got leverage. Thank you, musicians. We praise God for you. Thank you for your ministry today. One of my good friends and powerful preachers of the gospel, Pastor Deblier Snell, turned my attention towards the efficacy and power that's within the old video game called Pac-Man. While preaching, he shared this poignant and powerful parable of the gospel according to Pac-Man. Now, I'm dating myself because Pac-Man is an arcade video game from the 80s. Anybody remember Pac-Man? All right, in the game, the player's avatar is a yellow, round character that navigates a maze filled with small pellets and gains points as he eats the pellets. Now, there is a problem in this maze. For there are ghosts who linger and lurk in the hallways of the maze to try to stop Pac-Man from winning the game. Now they chase Pac-Man around the maze, and all they have to do is touch Pac-Man and he loses one of his three lives. But there is something else in the maze that is designed to help Pac-Man win. There are these glowing globes stationed strategically and purposefully around the maze. And all Pac-Man has to do is get to one of these globes. These globes are called energizers. So that as the ghosts chase him to take his life, if Pac-Man is being chased by the ghosts, all he has to do is get to the energizing globe of power before the ghosts get him. Now, you already missing your shout. If you know Pac-Man, you should know that when he eats the globe, something changes. The same ghosts who were chasing him now change color and begin to run from Pac-Man. Something in the globe gave power to Pac-Man. Something in the globe gave Pac-Man authority that he didn't have before. Something in the globe gave Pac-Man confidence that he didn't have before. The best players of Pac-Man understand that you don't spend all your time trying to eat the pellets because the enemy will eventually get you. The globes of power, the energizers, are always in the maze. But the key is to know when to use them. Don't miss this. So that when you get to where the energy, the power is, what was chasing you, you now have the power to chase it. Here's the life application, since some of y'all seem sleepy today. Life is not a game, but it does feel like a maze. Because we have to circumnavigate this life with all its twists and turns. It feels like a maze. And we don't have ghostly, ghastly enemies like in the game, but we do have spiritual enemies lurking in every corner, seeking to steal our quality of life and ultimately to steal our eternal life. These ghosts come after your joy. These ghosts of generations past try to steal our hope for the future. Ghosts chasing us down with the memories of our failures. But we have something in this life's maze with us. It has been strategically and purposefully placed in the corners, in the nooks and crannies of life. It has been positioned there in the morning, in the noonday, and in the evening. These globes of power, energizers, if you will, are called prayer. And if we can just get to the time of prayer, if we can just get in the position of prayer, if we can just get to the place of prayer, if we can just get in the mindset of prayer, we will then be given power to chase what's been chasing us. And I wonder if I've got a few people here who need power, because there's some stuff that's been chasing you. In fact, you barely got to the house of prayer today because of things that have been chasing you on Monday and Tuesday. And by Wednesday, they caught up with you and they stole your joy. On Thursday, you lost your patience. And am I talking to any real people here to know that there are things that are chasing you? But can I tell you, you are in the right place. For the Bible says, wherever two or three are gathered in my name, you create a house of prayer. And Jesus said, my people who are called by my name, if they humble themselves and pray, then I will hear from heaven and I will forgive their sin and heal their land. I want to let you know today that you've got leverage. Stay with me. I won't even get through all of this today, so this is just part one. We'll end it next week. In this maze of life, you got leverage. You got something in this life that gives you advantage over the enemy that's chasing you. But here's why most of you aren't excited about talking about prayer today. The problem is that we are too busy trying to win the game of life by getting all we can, that we don't leverage the power we have access to. See, the reason why I wasn't really good at Pac-Man, Sheldon, is because I didn't have a good strategy. What I would do is I was just focusing on the pellets, trying to get points. So I was trying to outrun the enemy and going around the energizers because I thought the goal of the game was just to win as many points. I didn't realize that my problem was I was too busy focusing on points that I did not get my power. Stay with me. And the reason I say leverage today, somebody shout leverage. Leverage, let me define it for you. Leverage is to use something. When you leverage, you use something you already have access to in order to achieve something new or better. I'll say it again, if you're taking notes at home, leverage, the practice when you leverage something is to use something you already have access to in order to achieve something new or better. And we already have access to the power of God, and yet we live in fear. We already have access to the promise of God, and yet we live in poverty. We already, as people of God, have access to all that God is and owns, and yet we still don't have discernment to know the difference between good and great. Ooh, God, Holy Ghost, help me to preach this. Prayer is how you leverage the power and authority of God, but we are too busy trying to win. Too busy trying to win all we can. We're too focused on winning the religious game of pretension. So we would rather look like a Christian than have the power of a Christian. We are too focused on working on our goals. Watch this, even if they are good goals, too busy in self-improvement to not allow the Holy Ghost to improve us from the inside out. And like my strategy in Pac-Man, we run for pellets instead of going for power. Ooh, you better preach this, Holy Ghost. Maybe this is why the hymn writer penned those words. What a friend we have in Jesus. All our sins and griefs to bear. What a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. But here's where we hang out. Oh, what peace we often forfeit. Oh, what needless pain we bear. Why? Because we keep running past the power and not taking everything to God in prayer. We are dealing with stuff we don't need to be dealing with because we are forfeiting our leverage. Our source of power is accessible, but we're too busy being sensible. And here's what I want you to know today. You got leverage in prayer when you accept what prayer is. I want to hang out here and set this up for these next 2 weeks because, if you're like me, when you hear somebody stand up to talk about prayer and you've been in church, around church, affiliated with church, you believe you already know everything there is to know about prayer. But if we did, then our families would look like what they look like. And if we did, our divorce rates wouldn't look like what they are. And if we did, there would be a greater sense of self-control to not say everything that comes to our mind. And here's what I want to free you from today and empower you to understand this. Most of us, even if you're not a Christian, practice some form of prayer. There are people from different faith traditions and religions that practice prayer and meditation and going into oneself and calming one's spirit and managing your energy and speaking affirmations over yourself. There are many people, even people who are not Christians, who pray, but may I suggest this? Because we have reduced the power of prayer to mindfulness. Because we have reduced the power of prayer to self-reflection. Oh, God, you're going to get this in a minute. Because we have reduced prayer to a practice of calming our anxiety in order to pursue our own goals, we have limited our potential because we are reaching into ourselves in order to gain power over what is coming against us, not realizing that the greatest power coming against us is us. God. And so that's why you meditate and you're okay for the day, but something can trigger you and now your meditation is thrown out the window because you reached into a limited well. A well that can run dry. And that's why I want to give you this today, because I want to suggest this to you. May I suggest it's because we have reduced the power of prayer because we misunderstood the premise of prayer. Oh, God. Here's the context. If you're with me, shout yes. If you're with me in the chat, you type yes. Now, the biblical context of Luke chapter 22 is this, that Jesus and his disciples have now come to the upper room. He's near the end of his ministry. He is about to have, they are having what we call and celebrate in Christian faith tradition, what we call Holy Communion. It is his last supper with the disciples. He's been there with the 12, but by the time we get down to verse 31 and 32, there are only 11 left. Don't miss it. For he started with 12, but Judas allowed the enemy to enter and possess him, and Judas left out to make the final preparation of Jesus' betrayal. It is here now that we find in verses 22 and 23 of Luke 22 that the disciples, the 11, are in a dispute. They are arguing. And what are they arguing about? They're arguing about who's going to be greatest in the kingdom of God that Jesus is about to bring to pass. You got 11 who have walked with him for 3.5 years. And on their last night with Jesus, these jokers choose to dispute, to fight, to debate, and get in an argument about who's going to be the greatest in the kingdom that actually requires humility. Oh, God. They're in the upper room having communion with Jesus. They're arguing over who's going to be the kingdom, who's going to have preference and position. They're fighting about who will have the position at the right hand and the left hand of the throne. And watch this. They're arguing about his kingdom in the presence of the king. Maybe you just missed it. If you're making notes, let me give you the first point I'm trying to really press home here, is that, they missed an opportunity to leverage the power of prayer. See, because when you leverage, you've got leverage when you understand that you are in the room with the one who makes things happen. They're arguing about where their position in the kingdom is going to be. And yet, the one who makes that choice is in the room. And it never dawned on them to ask Jesus how he goes about placing and positioning the disciples. Oh, okay, y'all gonna make me work hard today. They're fighting about stuff, worrying about stuff, concerned about stuff, but the person in the room with them, sitting at the table, has all the power to solve the dispute they're going through. Okay, let me come a little bit closer. So you're worrying about how you're gonna pay the bills, and y'all fighting over who gets what and what has position and what's most important and how's God gonna work this out, and yet you are sitting in the presence of the King who has all the power to change what you're worrying about. And you walked in here stressed into church. How am I going to pay this bill? How am I going to get this child through school? How am I going to keep my sanity as I'm juggling all these things? And what you don't understand is you actually have access to the one who can deal with what is worrying you. Oh, Holy Ghost, help me to preach this. That's why in Luke 11, when Jesus tells, I think I told you this, when Jesus tells the parable about prayer, and he says there's this man, right, who comes to another man at night. He knocks on the door, and he keeps saying, listen, I got some people who need some food. Open up and give me. Jesus, in telling this story, is trying to get us to know we are not the man on the outside knocking, trying to get God's attention, but we are the children on the inside who have full access to the Father. And I guess what I'm really trying to get you to understand is, why would you worry about what's going to happen when the King is sitting at your table? Why would you worry about how you're going to get through when the King woke you up this morning? Why would you worry about how you're going to pay that bill when the King, when the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, and you ain't never got to worry because he's got all you need. Your leverage is that you got to know, I'm trying to teach you this, sounds real simple, but it'll revolutionize your prayer. When you pray like you're in the room with Jesus, things begin to change. The reason some of y'all ain't getting no breakthrough in your prayer is you praying like a neighbor. You trying to get his attention, knocking on the door. Hey, Lord, please remember me. And that's why we approach him with such timidity. And you thinking it's because you are trying to reverence him. No, you ain't reverencing him. You're not acknowledging who you're talking to. See, if you knew he was your daddy and your daddy was the King, you would come up to him with boldness and say, now, daddy, I got some needs here. And I ain't going to talk to you like no neighbor, because a neighbor's got to get your attention. But because I'm in the house, watch this. So your leverage is, you got to know when you pray from the room, not outside the door. They're arguing about the kingdom, and the King is sitting at the table, and the King interrupts their dispute, their fight. And watch what he does. He says right there, he says, Simon, Simon. Gets his attention. Jesus calls, I want you to get this. Jesus calls Peter by his given name. Now, this is significant. Because Jesus has renamed Simon, son of Barjona, he renames him Peter. Huh. But when God calls people's name twice, it's a sign, of alarm and affection, of concern and compassion. Jesus calls him twice out of concern. He calls him Simon, Simon. He calls Peter by his real name and not by the name he gave him. He's not acting like Peter, which means rock. So he calls him Simon. Okay, all right. Y'all gonna make me work hard today. Peter is not acting up to his name Jesus gave him, which signified strength. And sometimes we don't act like who we've been called to be. We tend to have discussions and arguments that are not befitting our identity. We slide back into talking and into acting like we used to talk when we didn't know Jesus. Peter ain't acting like Peter, so Jesus calls him by his original name that he had when he met him out on the sea, cussing as a fisherman. He said, since you acting like Simon, I'm gonna call you Simon. But Jesus does this to get his attention. Peter would have been startled when Jesus did this because Jesus had called him Peter for 3.5 years. And yet now he reverts back to Simon. In fact, you should note that Peter was called Simon by his father because the tradition was that the mother gave birth to the children, but the father gave names to the children. And when Peter came to Jesus and was reborn in Christ, Jesus gave him this new name, Peter, which meant Jesus was now his spiritual father. Ooh, I hope y'all get this. So when Jesus says, Simon, Simon, he is trying to tell Peter that he is acting like his old father. In other words, Simon, I gotta call you Simon because you're not acting like my child right now. You are arguing about things that you have no control over. And I gotta get your attention because the way you are acting and the way you are talking is not like you. But note this, he calls him out of concern, not out of condemnation. He says, Simon, Simon, I want you to understand so I can get your attention. My daughter, Asia, we call her by her middle name, Asia, and I call my daughter baby girl all the time. Anyone who knows me knows I rarely, if ever, call Asia by her name. I call her baby girl, and she gets alarmed when I call her by her given name. One day I was talking to her over the phone. She's down there at Oakwood University, and we were talking about something, and I said, Asia, and she said, Daddy, why are you calling me Asia? I know I'm in trouble. She told me, I know I'm in trouble when you call me Asia, but I had to tell her, you are not in trouble with me. I'm just concerned that if you keep making this particular situation that you might end up in trouble. In other words, the reason I called her name was to get her attention. And every now and again in prayer, if you listen, he'll call your name. He does this not out of condemnation. He does this out of concern. And he does it because he wants you to know that if you keep making the same decision, if you keep going down the same path, you might end up in danger. Woo, don't miss it. Him calling your name is not condemnation. It's concern that you're about to go into self-condemnation. But in prayer, he not only calls him, watch this, he not only calls him twice, Simon, Simon, out of concern, he also does it out of compassion. Huh. All the disciples were in the room. Remember, 11 people are arguing. He says, Simon, Simon, the only one who is not present right now is Judas. The 11 disciples are in the room. Jesus calls Peter original name. Why? Because He singles him out of affection. He calls his name out of affection, out of compassion. Not just concern, but also compassion. Simon, Simon, I need to get your attention. See, Stephanie calls me a lot of wonderful names. My wife, she calls me a lot of wonderful names. She calls me baby. Yeah, she calls me, that's the next one I had, baby. She calls me honey. She'll call me Wes. And a host of other names and titles that you will never hear because it's none of your business. Amen. Hallelujah. You ain't getting those names and those titles. Yeah, okay. She's got a host of names that she calls me. But I also know that when she wants to get my attention, oftentimes she'll call my full name. Here's the thing. I'm not in trouble when she calls my full name. She's just trying to get my attention. Watch this. that's 23 years of marriage right there, yeah. Yeah, I'm not in trouble. She's just trying to get my attention. And if we're going to be honest today, you know this, baby, that if she's really upset, if I really hurt her feelings, she won't call my name at all. ain't no baby, ain't no honey, ain't no Wesley, ain't no Charles Wesley Knight, ain't none of that. Here's the point I'm making. The fact that Jesus calls Peter's name is a sign of affection. The fact that he's doing wrong and yet he still calls his name means that his behavior at the moment does not cancel or disqualify him from still getting his name called by God. Did you know that Jesus still calls your name? Prayer is not just you talking to God, but prayer is also God talking to you. Prayer is God talking, is Jesus talking to the Father about you. And every time he calls your name, it's because he loves you. In fact, you're missing the shout because the reason you got up is because he called your name. The reason why you're still in your right mind is because he called your name. The reason you are still here and sane is because he called your name. The reason you didn't cuss them out this week when they cut you off in traffic, it's because he called your name. The reason you didn't lose your mind, he called your name. He said, Tracy, Tracy, don't you say that. He said, Stephanie, Stephanie, hold your peace. He said, Jonathan, Jonathan, don't you get back at them. Thank God he called your name, and not just once, he called it twice, because he's letting you know it don't matter what you're doing, I can get your attention. Now, can I push it a little bit further? Now, he says, Simon, Simon, behold, Satan has demanded to have you. Satan has demanded to have you. Now, Jesus reveals something that is happening, don't miss this, in the spiritual realm that they cannot understand in the natural realm. While they are arguing about who will be greatest in the kingdom, and who will have great position in the kingdom, Jesus stops them to reveal to them that their argument had a spiritual dimension to it that they were not aware of. I want you to get this. Here's the second thing you need to note. You'll get leverage in the power of prayer when you know that there is a spiritual fight going on beyond the natural world. I'm going to say it again. Your leverage is when you know and acknowledge there is a spiritual fight going on beyond the natural world. I'll say it this way. Every argument, every division, every fight that has the potential to rupture a relationship has a spiritual dimension to it. Simply put, every time you argue, fight, I'm not talking about just disagreements. I'm talking about every time you are in contention with other people, there is both a natural reason and a supernatural reason for the fight. Oh, God, I hope y'all get this today. In the natural, they were fighting over position and placement. But in the supernatural, they were being influenced by the original evil one that always strives for power. Was it not Lucifer who wanted higher power and position in the kingdom? Oh, God. So while they're arguing, all they see is that we arguing about position, but they don't know the fight started when the evil one got into the mind of somebody and influenced them to do what he did. Every argument, every division, every discord, every sense of division has spiritual foundations. In the marriage, you are not just fighting over the money. There is a spiritual dimension to it. In the dating relationship, listen, sister, you ain't just fighting over who is not getting what they need. There is a spiritual dimension to it. On your job, you are not just fighting over who gets the promotion or who gets the favor of the supervisor. There's a spiritual dimension to it. Married couple, it's not just about who does the dishes or the budget. Brother, it's not just about what you're not getting and how you're unsatisfied. There's a spiritual dimension to it. And if you only think the fight is about what you see, then you are in a disadvantage. See, I want you to get this. They're fighting in the natural. Jesus stops them and says, you don't understand. While y'all have been fighting, Satan's been demanding you. He's been demanding that I give you, y'all, to him. The argument looks like it's between people, but it's really between two spiritual entities. One wants to give you life, the other one wants to take life. The accusation, see, Satan is not his name. Lucifer is. I told you before, Satan is not the name of the devil. Satan is the title and the job of the devil. Satan, or as scholars would say, Satan. Satan is a title that means accuser, prosecutor, one who makes up lies in order to get what he wants. And when we are fighting and hurting each other down here in the natural, Jesus peels back the veil to help us to understand that the fight ain't over what we're fighting over. The fight is really in the supernatural. So two married people, y'all gonna get real quiet right through here. Two married people don't just grow apart. There's an evil spirit at work. You don't just fight and fuss. Come here, churches. Every time the church board gets together, there's an evil spirit at work. Because sometimes we make excuses and call things cultural when they're really spiritual. Okay, y'all. So I know some churches, I ain't gonna say exactly where they are, but I know some churches where they will excuse the fact that they always challenge everything the pastor says, or they're always fighting board meetings. Well, that's just our culture. We came from a specific island, or we come from a certain country, and that's just the way we are. No, the devil is a liar. That's not just the way you are. There's a spirit at work. It's only a spirit that would make you look at a plan, and every time they give you the plan, you gotta find something wrong with it. It's a spirit that makes you judge people based on what they're wearing or not wearing to church. It's a spirit that makes you say everything that comes to your mind and you start criticizing people because they don't do what you do. That's not cultural, that's spiritual. And he says, and that spirit demanded to have you. So the argument's happening. Y'all okay? Y'all still with me? I'm almost through. Watch this. He says, behold, Satan has demanded while y'all were talking, while y'all were fighting. While y'all were talking about the kingdom, I was fighting in the spiritual realm, and the enemy demanded to have all of you. Why? Because he already got Judas. The same night he got Judas. And he said, now that I got one, I need the other 11. I know you're used to fights and fussing and cussing and drama and trauma. I know we post fight videos on Twitter and Instagram and Facebook, assault videos and videos of people getting cussed out on black Twitter and black Instagram. But while you are looking at the fight, what you don't see is in the fight, it's revealing Satan has demanded someone. I know we're used to marriages breaking up all the time, but it reveals that Satan has demanded the souls of the children who will be affected by the divorce. Y'all ain't saying nothing to me right now. I know we're used to single parent homes and we run around with badges of honor saying, I don't need no man. I'll raise these kids by myself. And listen, listen, God has blessed you and you made it through. But you've got to understand, whenever there is breakage, whenever there is attack on the home, whenever there is divorce, whenever there is discord, it means Satan has demanded someone. And we have normalized trauma, celebrated failure, made excuses for brokenness, not understanding that when the enemy comes against a family, he ain't coming after just the husband and the wife. He's going after the kids and their kids and their kids. The fight is the revelation that there is a deeper fight going on. But here's the grace in this moment. When Jesus says, Satan has demanded to have you. Don't miss your shout. The shout is, Satan knows he's got to ask permission. Oh, I feel good. Jesus said, now I know he asked. I know he made demands. I know he's requested. I know he sent in his form and filled out his application. But I'm saying access denied. You can't have them because they belong to me. He might make demands, but he can't have you. His asking Jesus is a sign that even he knows that if he's going to get to you, he's got to come through Jesus. So if you belong to Jesus, it doesn't matter what the enemy demands, he can't have you. Even if you act crazy, he still can't have you. Even if you ain't living right, he still, somebody missed that, he still can't have you. Do you understand? Peter was about to go and deny Jesus, and Jesus said, even though you about to act the fool, he still can't have you. And I need about 30 people right now to shout unto God that him having me is not dependent on me acknowledging him, that even when I deny him, he still got me. I gotta go. I gotta go. He says he's demanded to have you, watch this, to sift you as wheat. Now, we don't really understand what that means because we don't sift wheat. But back in that culture, you got to understand what sifting is. I'm trying to help you. This is going to bless somebody right through here because you've missed the agenda of the enemy in your life. And that's why we let him have his way, because we don't know what he's really after. The enemy is after wheat. He's not trying to destroy you. He wants the best of you. Ooh, you're gonna get it. Sifting of wheat is the process of separating the useful grain from the useless chaff. You can use the wheat to do great things, but the chaff is the part that is left over and useless. Oh, help me, Holy Ghost. The enemy is not trying to take your life, at least not yet. Before he takes it, what he's trying to do is get the best of your life so that you leave the rest for God. So you thought he was trying to kill you when he's really just trying to get the best of you. And the reason why you don't notice, help him to get a Holy Ghost, what he's doing is because he ain't killed you yet. So you think you're okay. But what he's saying is, I don't need to kill you. I just need the best of you so that you give God chaff. He wants to sift you, my brother, so that your work gets the best of you and your family gets the chaff. He wants to sift you, sister, so that your family gets your attention and your self-care gets the chaff. He wants to sift you so that your church, you sanctimonious brother, gets all your time, but your kids can't get eye contact from you because you're too busy going to Bible study and then the board meeting and then the business meeting and then to evangelistic meeting, and all your family gets is the chaff. And you know, I can tell by looking at a whole lot of homes that a whole lot of us grew up with chaff. He said he's demanded the best of you so that all you give me is what's left. And I'll finish this next week. Here's the last thing. He says, but I, he said, I have prayed for you. He made demands because he saw what y'all were fighting over. But I have prayed for you. See, you got leverage because, oh God, because of the one who prays for you. See, when we think of prayer, we think of talking to God about what we need. But the power, but the premise of prayer that gives power to prayer is that prayer doesn't start with you. Prayer starts with Jesus praying for you. Christianity is the only religion where it's God does not have to be appeased by offerings and prayers, but it's God prays for the children. You just missed it. He said, I've prayed for you, not a priest. I've prayed for you, not the high priest. I prayed for you. This ain't Moses, Abraham, Isaac, or Jacob. I prayed for you. And the way you know everything gonna be all right is because when you get your prayer wrong, he says, I prayed for you, for he ever liveth to make intercession. Here it is. Here's why he prayed for him. Huh. He said, Simon, I've prayed for you. When he was talking about, he says, listen, Satan has demanded all of you. But in the Greek, when he turns verse 32, he says, but I have prayed for you. Don't miss it. Satan has demanded all of you. Jesus says, but Simon, Peter, I prayed for you. Pastor Ty Gibson, my friend and colleague in ministry, helped me to understand this premise. Ooh, this is going to blow your mind. He said, prayer is actually a property dispute. That prayer is not just talking to God a laundry list of things you need. Prayer is actually the negotiation of property. God. So that when he said, I prayed for you, what Jesus was really saying is he was demanding, the prosecutor, Satan was asking that I give you as my property to him. He said, but I prayed to stake a claim that you belong to me. The deed will state the location of the property, the cost of the property, and what was paid for the property. He said in the spirit, he asked to see the deed. Well, I told him the location of the property is all of humanity, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. The cost of the property is there must be blood shed for the remission of sins. And who paid for the property? The precious blood of Jesus. When you pray, here's how you get leverage. When you understand that you belong to God, Jesus made a legal claim to you. And here's the thing, it doesn't matter what you do, it doesn't matter what you say, because he makes the claim on you, knowing you will deny him. I'm done. It's a property dispute. That's why we were told by Jesus to pray in his name. You thought in Jesus, saying in Jesus' name, perhaps is some addendum we tack on the end of a prayer to sound pious. In Jesus' name is not something we say to push the prayer through. In Jesus' name is not some theological phrase we use to impress the Father. No, in Jesus' name is not theological. In Jesus' name is a legal claim of ownership. Ooh, God, in the time of Greco-Roman Empire, the deed of any property was proven by a seal on the parchment that carried the name of the owner. And that's where we get the phrase, the property is in his name. Oh, God. That's why he said, when you pray, you gotta say in Jesus' name, so that when the enemy comes to make a claim for your property, you say, no, my joy is in Jesus' name. You say, no, my peace is in Jesus' name. No, you can't have my children because they're in Jesus' name. Devil, you can't have my marriage because it's in Jesus' name. It ain't theological, it's legal. It means it belongs to God. And if it belongs to him, he's responsible for it. So the next time you open your mouth to ask God for anything, you ought to stop and praise God for this one thing, that he owns you even when you disowned him. And is there anybody here who's going to walk into this week and say, I'm living in Jesus' name? The deed is already signed and sealed with his blood. I'm going to worship in Jesus' name. I'm going to trust him in Jesus' name. I'm going to lift holy hands in Jesus' name. I'm going to believe in Jesus' name, because if it's in his name, then it, the responsibility belongs to him. You got leverage, because this is the only faith where you don't just pray to your God prays for you. Do you know the significance of that statement? But I've prayed for you. You got leverage because Jesus, God, is talking to himself about your situation. That's how you know the prayer is going to be the right prayer and it's going to get answered, because it's God talking to God about what God can do for you. But you got to know that you belong to him. And hear this, you belong before you behave. You belong before you behave. This happened, and the very next text, he says, now you're going to deny me, but I already claimed you. You're going to tell people three times, you don't even know me. But before you do that, I'm going to claim you. Come here, come here. Grace precedes your denial. Whew. who wants to live in Jesus' name? You want the deed to the property of your heart, your mind, your life to be in his name. If that's you, I want you to meet me at this altar right there online, right there online. If you're watching, you're saying, that's me. Just say in Jesus' name. Just put it in Jesus' name. That means I want everything that I do, everything that I go after, every relationship that means something to me in my life. I want it to be the property of Jesus. He is for you. He said, I have prayed for you. Next week we'll talk about it. He said, I'm living just so I can talk about you to the Father. I want you to know today that you can walk in victory because he, Jesus, your Lord and Savior, is praying for you. It would be enough for him to simply give his life, shed his blood to secure our salvation, but he doesn't stop there. He said, I paid the price to secure your salvation, but now I'm going to keep talking to God about you so you can walk in your salvation. Your heads are bowed, your eyes are closed. Here's, I want to pray a prayer over you that you will walk with this power, that you will use your leverage. Father, in the name of Jesus. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for loving us in spite of ourselves. We thank you that when the enemy demanded to have us, that you claimed us even when we didn't act like you. Thank you, God, that you don't give up on us even when we are tempted to give up on ourselves. Father, right now, in the name of Jesus, I pray that every person in this building gathered around the altar in the aisles, every person online who said they want their life to be in your name, that you will now cover them. And as the enemy is asking for them, that you will claim them so that they will have victory, so that they will have victory in every area of their lives. Thank you, Jesus, for doing this in your power and in your strength. And we know we have the victory. In Jesus' name, let everybody say amen. Come on, put your hands together. You believe that you're living in his name. Listen, online, even in the building, if you're here and you're saying, listen, I love Jesus, or I'm coming to know Jesus, I'm being reintroduced to Jesus, I'd love to give my life to this Jesus. On the screen, we're going to put up the QR code. You can be able to do that. But if you're in the building, for those of you online, the QR code will be there. You'll be able to, in just a moment, yeah, you'll be able to just open your phone app there, generates the form. You could say, listen, I want to give my life to Jesus. Or I already believe in Jesus. I'm living in his name, but I want to be part of a church that serves and ministers in his name. I'm looking for a church home. You can do that even now. For those of you who are in the building, you're saying, listen, I want to be part of Revision Church Atlanta. Or I want to learn more about this Jesus who prays for me. Because I'm used to talking to a God and trying to get a God's attention. But I want to learn more about this God who talks for me. And I want to give my life to Jesus or learn more about him. We want you at the end of this service, hear me, to meet us down front. We've got the pastors that will be down front to receive you. If you're saying, I want to learn more about this Jesus, I want to join this church that's living in Jesus' name, or I want to be even baptized in the next baptism, which is a public declaration that my life is in Jesus' name. God bless you as you return to your seats. The appeal has been made. It's now up to you to walk in the invitation that Jesus has given. that you can live in his name. Stay with us online. Stay with us in the building. We're almost through. We're about to just raise our offering, give unto God out of thanksgiving. Has God spoken to your heart today? Come on, put your hands together. Pastor Tiffany is going to come and lead us in the offering. We thank you in advance for how you're going to give. We thank you for all that you have already given online and in this building. And we want you to remember that today, if you made a decision to join the church, decision to give your life to Jesus, meet us in the front. God bless you.
Amen. I am so grateful that God has chosen me. He has chosen you even before we have chosen him. You know, the word of God says that while we are yet sinners, that Christ died for us. It is not us that has chosen, but is him that has chosen us. And I am so grateful that I can say he is mine and I am his. So I'm just so grateful for that message today, that Jesus intercedes, that he prays for me, he prays for you, and it's because of him that we are living today. Today, I just want to invite you guys to join me in giving a praise gift to the Lord, either through tithes or offerings. You can either give through the QR code that is on the screen. You can just hold up your phone and snap that QR code, and it'll lead you to the link where you can give online. And there are some other easier ways to give. If you're like, you know, the QR code thing isn't really my thing, here are some other easy ways for you to give. You can give on the website, revisionchurchatlanta.org/give. It's an easy way there. You can also give through PayPal. If PayPal is your thing, you can go through Revision Church Atlanta, or with Cash App, which is $RevChurchATL. So those are some easy ways where you can give directly online. Your tithe goes to support the ministries that are happening throughout our world, and your offerings support the ministries that are happening locally here through your local church right here at Revision. We're so excited that we are going to be starting our prayer and fasting. It's starting tomorrow, January 22nd, and we're going to February 11th. So here's how it's going to work, friends. We're going to start off every morning. You will get a text message with the instructions of what we're praying for that day, okay? So if you have not signed up to get our texts, we want you to text Revision ATL to the number on the screen, okay? If you can't see the number, it is 833-406-0075, okay? So you're going to text Revision ATL to that number, and that way you can get the daily message of what we'll be praying for that day. So each day, we're going to pray for three different areas, okay? The first one are our personal prayer requests. We are invited to come boldly before the throne of grace, that we can receive his mercy and grace to help us in our time of need. So we're going to present our requests before the Lord. The second one is that we're going to be praying for specific individuals in our lives, either classmates or friends or neighbors or professors or somebody in your life that you know that you want to pray for, to pray that that soul or souls will be reintroduced to Jesus, okay? We're praying for people who are spiritually curious. They are wanting to know a little bit, who is this Jesus? So we want to ask you to prayerfully think of 1 to 3 people in your life that you want to pray for specifically for the next 21 days. And I believe that God is going to do something amazing in their lives, and he's going to reveal himself to them. You know, Jesus gave his whole life. He said if there had been one lost soul, Christ would have died for that one. If it had been only Eve or only Cain or only me, Christ would have died for that one person. So let's pray together for that soul or souls that God brings to your life, someone that's in your your sphere of influence, okay? And then finally, we're gonna pray for our community, okay? We're gonna pray that the Spirit of God will rest upon our community, our neighborhood, our city, and every day. we're going to pray that God will do something in our neighborhood. Okay, so let's pray for this together. Join us on Zoom on Wednesday mornings, bright and early. We'll be sending you guys a Zoom link through text message so that we can pray together as a community, okay? And then finally, we will be fasting this coming week from social media. You guys pray for me. Secular entertainment. Week two, we're going to pray. We're going to fast from meat, dairy, and fried foods. And week three, we're going to fast from sweets, desserts, carbonated drinks, and energy drinks. We're going to do it together, church family. We're going to do it together. By the grace of God. You know, there's this quote that I really like. It says, when every other voice is hushed, and in quietness we wait before him, the silence of the soul makes more distinct the voice of God. And Psalm 46:10 says, be still and know that I am God. And I believe that in the next 21 days, that the Lord will reveal himself to us and we can hear his voice. All right, finally, we just want to invite you, if you're here in the building, you can pick up your tax form in the lobby. Sister Belinda has that for us. Or if you are online, you can email her at treasure@revisionchurchatlanta.org. That's treasure, as in my treasure is laid up in heaven, okay? treasure@revisionchurchatlanta. And we also want to invite you to stay with us. And we're going to head over to the cafeteria right here. Tables are set up. We're going to come together to package food to feed 10,000 people. So lunch is served for you. Please don't go away. Stay with us for a little while longer. We're going to do this to serve our community today. So we're so grateful that we're here today. We just want to invite you to stand with us as we close in prayer. Father, we are just so grateful for the presence of your Spirit with us today. We are grateful that Jesus is interceding and praying for us today. And we just want to connect with you, connect with heaven, and just say we're so grateful that you have saved us, even though Satan is trying to sift us in so many areas of our lives, that you have prayed for us and that you're saving us today. And now, Lord, as we continue throughout this Sabbath, we continue to serve us others, we pray that you fill us with your joy, that you fill us with expediency, that we can see your city, your people, experience love and experience joy and even have the meals that they are needing, because this is what you want to do for people today. Bless us now with your Spirit, we pray in the name of Jesus. Amen. Thank you, friends. We will see you online next Sabbath.